1905, Jan Arnald defended his doctoral dissertation on Swedish modernist writer Arthur Lundqvist. The title of his thesis was The Tyranny of Genres, and it explores Lundqvist's authorship and his constant transgression of genre. And I'm of course simplifying this and maybe also misunderstanding it. However, the point I want to make is that one of Jan Arnald, or Arne Dahl, one of his many strengths is his own transgression of borders. He's transgressing the borders of genres, but also geographical ones. And he has for many years now explored Sweden and Europe. And this leads me to the title of his talk, Finding a Voice for Europe Through Crime Fiction.
Yes. Thank you very much. Yeah, yes, that's true. I have a background as an academic. 20 years ago, so this would be straight from the writer's workshop, not from the idea. Which means you have to bear with me. Europe is no longer itself, or rather, it's once again starting to look. There have always been wars between nations, fights among neighbors, religious differences, language differences, cultural differences, different approaches to armies and dictators and power. From the big empires to the micro empires to the new big empires, war, war. It would be nice to be able to say that this ended with the rise of liberal democracy, the fundamental rule of one person, one vote, but it's not entirely true. Democracy has never been completely perfect. As we all know from history, democracy can even be overturned. There were a few reasonably functioning democracies in the world before the Second World War. But there were still colonies, still colonial brutality going on. But that was far away, and it only marginally touched the Europeans in their daily lives. When the horror of anti-humanitarian dictatorship came close, when it exploded in the heart of Europe, left the continent in ruins and tens of millions of people dead, maybe this was the first time the Europeans saw the true scale of brutal dictatorship and hard-boiled nationalism. When the dust settled, the countries in the central world, Second World War, looked back at the past in different ways. One half decided, more or less voluntarily, to look back at the war as a heroic victory, where the Great Red Army, at huge costs, had defeated fascism. To them, it was capitalism and a very weak democracy that opened the door to fascism. They wanted the real equality that only communism could create. Dressed in the increasingly more ill-fitting costume of the people, they allowed the barbarianism of the war basically just to continue. The Aalborg saw the war as a big, huge loss. They looked back at their past 1500 years and saw nothing but war and violence. How could this be prevented in the future? How could they make sure that nothing like the big rise of fascism would once again destroy democracy? The Western European answer was a union. A union between the old enemies based on trade, democracy, open society, and some kind of welfare state and peace. That was the ideal. And in a way, time proved them right. In different ways, the original six countries were joined, first by the reluctant, like the UK, then the last remaining Western European dictatorships that finally became democracies, like Greece. Then by those who could no longer claim to be neutral, like Sweden. And finally, by the Eastern European countries that had at last been liberated by Poland. And then they were 28, the biggest economical unit that the world has ever seen. And maybe that was the problem, that the Union was more and more becoming an economical unit. The ideals of peace and an open society were still there, but more and more there was an open inner market, a more or less common foreign currency, free movement within the outside borders. We were becoming less and less nations, more and more a union. But this also established free trade and capitalism as a self-evident standard, and established as a fact that the gap between the rich and the poor needed to grow. Thus, the critique against the European Union was mostly coming from the left. It's hard to say when this changed. There were always small strains of ethnical nationalism, often with an anti-democratic touch, within post-war Europe. But they were small and did never really stand a chance against the established democratic parties. But this did change. Nowadays, there is not one single election in Europe anymore without the fear of something anti-democratic gaining ground, or at least something nationalistic. Often with the assistance of a Russia that is doing, always doing its best to shatter the European Union. Europe is once again retracting, moving towards smaller units back to the national state. The critique against the Union is no longer coming from the left, but from the right, the extreme right. And it usually goes hand in hand with anti-democratic tendencies, the desire for a strong leader, closed borders, national culture, no foreigners, anti-abortion, anti-gay tendencies. It is always the dream of a lost childhood. And suddenly the light shone differently upon the EU. With all its problems, it stood out as the guarantee for a democratic Europe, as opposed to all the different nationalistic movements. And the critique from the left had become more and more silent. So came 2016, Brexit. Nationalists around Europe saw that it was possible to leave the Union and chair. And Donald Trump. Nationalists around the world saw that it was possible to infiltrate the democratic system and cheer. This is the Europe I see now. It was not quite the Europe I saw when I wrote my European quarter in the years 2010 to 2013. What I see is this clear desire to return to the old national states. But is that even possible anymore? The paradox is that our biggest crisis today, climate change, moves us in the same direction. Towards smaller units, less travel, less trade, more short distance movement, more local exchange. So maybe the nationalists were right all along. Everybody should just stay at home, minding their own business. I still don't think so. I will remain an internationalist. The climate change crisis can only be solved internationally, globally. That's also why I've always been skeptical about the term Nordic Noir or Scandinavian meaning. I'm very grounded in Sweden and probably in a way very Swedish, but my themes have always been international. The title of this lecture is Finding a Voice for Europe Through Climate Fiction. This will, I fear, be my voice. For some who are starting to write crime fiction now and having some reasonable ambition beyond making money, the path will most likely be very different. The times are adapted out different, and I will return to this at the end of the lecture. It now seems that the real division, the gulf in our societies, is between nationalists and internationalists, not between the rich and the poor. This I didn't expect when I wrote my European quarter. this was really a continuation of what made me start crime writing, or writing crime fiction in the first place, in the 90s. It was Follow the Money. The 90s was the era of neoliberalism, the aftermath of Reagan Thatcher era, which basically was the revenge of the rich. Enough welfare state now, enough equality, enough restrictions, greed works. Let the rich be rich and be richer. Which in my eyes lead to the more dangerous society. The rich got more dangerous. Without moral borders, they can do anything, cross any border they like. The poor got more dangerous because they had nothing to lose. And the growing middle class also became more dangerous. In order to stay out of poverty, they had to join the new system, side with the rich, take big loans, buy their apartments, invest in the stock exchange. Last year I celebrated 20 years as a crime writer. This year I've started writing my 20th book of crime fiction. When I look back at these books in these years, I realize they also form a timeline of my relationship to Europe. It moves from nervous curiosity, a slowly open door from the very north of the continent, based on a growing realization that very few of the big crimes of our times are domestic. And it was the big crimes that really interested me. Those connected to the growing inequality of Sweden. Then the books became more naturally European, the Otkop series, which I will return to later, and finally, so far. I simply left the European scene, returned to my childhood area, and started writing something completely different, more like psychological thrillers. Or at least it was the ambition to leave Europe and politics behind, at least until the dust had settled. I started small. In Sweden in the late 90s, but already my early investigators in the so-called intercrime series, they call the A Group, the A Unit, were dealing with international crimes. Sweden had recently made a rather international turn after having for decades more or less isolated itself in the belief that we were independent, neutral, and, to be honest, a bit special. But the Berlin Wall had fallen, we had joined the European Union, and all of Europe came closer from all directions. The crimes of Europe also came closer. One could probably say that I slowly opened myself to Europe. When we are talking about finding a voice, allow me a short detour to the moment I found my voice. Not primarily for egocentric reasons, but because this may also say something about finding a voice, maybe not for Europe, but through Europe. I recently did a DNA test. I was simply interested in my roots. It turned out that I was really a Scandinavian. I mean, like Viking Scandinavian. There were minor elements of French, English, Finnish, but very long ago, obviously. No, my family had stay at home, several generations back. My mother was the first in her family to even finish high school. She eventually became a teacher. My father went through the military and also ended up as a teacher. In 1955, he traveled through the devastated continent to be engaged to be married in Paris. 2 decades later, they had 3 sons. Managed to buy a caravan and decided to travel through Europe from camping site to camping site, slowing down traffic all over the continent. In the 2 summers of 74 and 75, I was 11, 12, Europe opened up to me. I saw a much bigger, very different world from the boring Stockholm suburb where I grew up. This was also the time when I found reading, and eventually writing. Far too young, I became a vivid crime fiction and thriller reader, and the books books I wrote in a few years are very much thrillers and very European, and of course, very bad. Still, I do believe that traveling experience paved the way to writing. There was such an abundance of impressions, so much to describe and try to understand, that writing became my way of sorting everything that was going on in my poor, underdeveloped brain and body and maybe the soul. And what I really loved was telling stories. The world disappeared, I went into another room where everything happened, and you know, I was mesmerized by the world of fiction. But of course I need to study to get a real job. After having spent a couple of years, more or less, believing that I would like to be a computer engineer or an astrophysicist, I surrendered. Literature returned to me, mostly through European, American, Latin American, Russian novels, but not crime fiction. That I had, of course, grown out of. After a long interrail summer through Europe, I started studying literature. I wanted to be a writer, that was all. But to be a writer, you first and foremost need to be a reader. I got entangled in the university world, the world of knowledge and maybe even wisdom, while trying to become a writer. I was mostly inspired by European experimental novels, French, German, and Latin American novels. But it was a bit problematic to be 24 and inspired by Noble Man and Garcia Marquez. I felt this would be a couple of times. It was during another journey to Greece that I found my theme, the massacre of the Greek island Chios, birth of the hunger in the year of 1822. It turned out to be a mixture of historical novel, experimental novel, interrail novel, introspective novel, European novel, and it was published in January 1990, and Jan Arnald was the first 90s author in Sweden. Then got even more entangled in the university world, and I was also becoming one of the most productive literary critics in the 90s. I moved into smaller forms of my own writing, poetry, short stories, experimental tests. But my own writing started to be swallowed by academic writing, review writing. Maybe that was the real path of my life. I finished my dissertation in 1995. I was a PhD at the age of 32. I also had two small children and a big crisis. I thought I had to choose. Either I followed this path of academic work and criticism, and maybe add one or two collections of poetry per day. Or I do what I came here for. My literary writing had come to a full stop. I was too busy or too overambitious to produce anything. It was a real writer's block. In order to return to that mesmerizing feeling of telling a good fictional story that got me into literature in the first place, something radical needed to be done. I needed to write in a new way, and I needed to be somebody else. I simply needed to become a new writer. My interest had changed from the introvert to the extrovert. I was interested in what kind of a world my two daughters would grow up in, much more than in my own inner world. And I wanted to have fun writing, be productive, once again mesmerized by fiction, storytelling, creation, and try to interpret the times we live in. Politically speaking, the times were interesting, with a clear shift in politics. The wall had fallen at exactly the time when democracy was defined by neoliberalism, by a catch-and-grab mentality that suited the new oligarchs of Russia perfectly. The connections between the oligarchs and the mafia was, however, not yet clear. But literally speaking, the times were also interesting. There was a new dawn for crime fiction, on the horizon, even grand vision that was not from the UK and the US. So this was like Annie Mankel and the Bocanessa or European successors. I read them both with critical enthusiasm, learning as much how to do things as how not to do things. But it was also a time of sampling, of ironically reusing old and seemingly antiquated genres. For example, Paul Auster, in the Umberto Eco, reused grand fiction in very different ways. You may even call them diametrically opposed. Eco said yes to the genre, and that Sherlock Holmes resurfaced in the Middle Ages, while Auster said no by letting Philip Marlowe get lost in conspicuous New York during his vain chase for traces. It was, of course, the name of Rose and New York trilogy, and both of them used the elements of crime fiction in a very playful and yet very serious way. All of these set me on the road back to my early crime fiction reading. Could this way backward be my new way forward? Only if I could turn myself into a different platform. I decided to use the method of Kierkegaard and Pessoa in order to find a new and different author persona. So I invented a second writer, a productive author who really enjoyed himself while writing. This was Arne Dahl, arisen from the ruins of my surname, Arnold. This new author needed different devices to keep creative, not getting caught in the old writer's block. One device was a series, 10 books in 10 years for the same characters, partly as a homage to my most important predecessors, Carla Waller, my father, and Carla Waller was with. This in turn meant that I had to create characters interesting enough to spend a decade together. It couldn't be a lonely book, that would be too boring. It had to be a team, almost like a collective storytelling, an ensemble. If I were tired of one character, another one could step in, like in Chester. So device two was the team. People I would like to hang out with for 10 years, but who are also kind of representative aspects of today's Sweden. Julian, Chesterman, Jorge Alves, Sora Sandberg, and so on, Diego. The third productivity creating device of the newborn Arne Dahl was structural, but it also fitted my thematic ambitions to try to find new types of drama, year by year, that would say something about the zeitgeist or the small changes in our mentality. So I would look for real crimes that were morally interesting in the very year when I was writing, and based the fiction on them. Because that is what I thought and still think that crime fiction was extremely suited for, keeping an eye on the borders between the legal and illegal, because these are also the borders of our societies. What new crimes appear? What crimes get normalized and soon legal? What crimes are considered the worst? Where is there a difference between the legal, between what is legal and what is just, and so on? In my first book, Misterioso, I used the first big international finance crisis in the mid-90s as a background, the way it affected ordinary people in Sweden. It also involved Estonia and the Russian mafia, a rather new phenomenon in Sweden at that time. Then the international door opened up more and more into the four Europa Mus, which is where the European door slams wide open. It's basically a book about trafficking, also a rather new phenomenon at the time. But it also involves Europe's tragic past and Sweden's hidden past as the creator, the creators of race biology. It's also a lot about very different European police systems and mentalities and whether it's possible to overbridge them. I return to the theme later books like number 7, Requiem, which also included the Cold War and its remnants today. It was a book about the road to a fossil-free world that was once sketched upon in Europe, but forgotten after the oil wars, the Second World War. After having finished the A-group series, the Interprime series, then the Arne Dahl days were supposed to be over. 10 books. Was I tired of crime fiction? Had the journey come to a natural end? Wasn't it time to move back to real literature? I actually did. I wrote a completely different book in my real name and a strange coda in the name of Arne Dahl. But the thrill, the satisfaction, the pleasure of writing crime fiction had taken root inside me. And the spark came in 2008-2009 when the big finance crisis changed a lot, without anybody really understanding it. It struck down a number of countries in Europe, and the whole thing actually looked like one gigantic crime. Never had the world of white-collar crime opened its doors of white. These were strange times. There was hope in the world. Barack Obama had just become president of the United States. After the Bush era and the Iraq War, the time of strange surveillance and culture war should be over. There was also hope in Europe. The European Union had never been stronger. There were talks going on about how to increase the cooperation, including the police and security matters. Maybe the constant problems when different police forces of Europe must work together could be solved by having a European police force, unbound on nationalities like a European FBI, expanding Europol to also involve active police operations. At exactly this time, the finance crisis blew most of the world away. There was a strange synergy to it. I started my crime fiction writing with the effects of the first international finance crisis in the 90s. And I started the second series in the aftermath of the second big international finance crisis. In the world of the OPCOP series, the plans of creating a European FBA have been realized. My old cop, Paul Young, leads a secret test unit within Europol, consisting of police officers from most of the European countries. I realized that this had to be big crimes, big team, big themes. Structurally, it was an expansion on my storytelling. I had to test the borderlines of crime fiction. And I saw from the beginning that this would be thicker books, a quartet of fat books that could be read like one gigantic novel about the organized crime in Europe. And the borderline between crime fiction, thriller, and spy novel would have to fall. In Sweden, the Aalborg series is called crime fiction. In, for example, Germany, they call it thriller. Once again, I tried to follow the money. It led me to a gigantic web of intertwined international crimes. From the finance crisis rose all kinds of organized crime in Europe, and the research was massive. I cover human trafficking, financial crimes, money laundering, tax evasion through offshore banks, mafia turning seemingly legal, environmental crimes, climate change and crimes, the mafia world, arms trade, drug trade, right-wing extremism, the oil and mine industry's weak behavior, private security companies engaged in war, guns for hire everywhere, the rapidly growing mercenary industry, rogue uncontrolled illegal search, altering the very essence of man, surveillance to death, you name it. This was my attempt to find a voice for you through crime fiction. You could probably say that this now almost 10 years old series is still pretty accurate. But there were things I didn't really see coming. If somebody would attempt such a strange endeavor today, there is probably a list of things that need to be included that I think we miss. This is such a list. 1. Climate change. The acute seriousness of this threat didn't become really clear until a couple of years ago. There is no way of finding a voice for Europe without intervening. Somehow, someway. 2. The feminist uprising. An international Me Too movement aiming for the heart of the patriarchal society. This will be a long and hard struggle against thousands of years of deeply rooted traditions. 3. Russian and international interference in democratic elections. Not only through social media, but through hacking the very voting machines in strategic places. 4. The close connection between Russian government, the oligarchs, the spy organizations, the military, and the mafia. It's a new insight that all of this somehow belongs together. 5. Fake news. That this would be such an industry, that the truth so fast would be so radicalized. That science in big areas of society no longer count. 6. The mobbed up criminal in the White House. A gangster and dictator lover in the heart of Western democracy. This, the editors of a book would have cut immediately. He's too ugly. 7. One country leaving the EU based on social media lies. The truths that keep appearing about Brexit are astonishing. 8. Gang shootings in the streets. Ghettoization, if I may say so, of large parts of the suburbs of Europe. It's also a specific Swedish problem. Whole areas dominated by criminal gangs and, to a certain extent, religious extremists. 9. Waves of immigration turned on and off through political decisions outside the borders of the EU, slowly tearing Europe apart. It's a serious test of humanistic values throughout the EU and a vital test of our capacity for integration. 10. And the new rift in our societies. When I started writing the Aalborg series, I couldn't imagine this shift of focus, that the real abyss that is ripping our societies apart is between nationalism and internationalism, not between the rich and the poor. But is it true? Is this the real division? Is really the chasm between nationalists and internationalists bigger and more important than them, and that between the rich and the poor? Or is it more like a big PR victory for the ultra rich, those who have the means, power, and capacity to create big strategies? Put the blame on somebody else. It could be immigrants, it could be the democratic system. Like, vote for a well-known criminal like Trump just to blow the system apart with the help of autocrats around the world and keep the immigrants out. If you want to find a voice for Europe through crime fiction these days, it's easy to leave out this aspect. There are so many other issues that feel more threatening. But the ultra-rich men of the world are stronger than ever, we mustn't forget. And that is still the main reason for the fact that we live in a very dangerous world. I personally had enough of this dangerous world of the poor books of the Aalborg series. I was tired of looking into the dark corners of the world. It was starting to get to me. But I was also tired of the solid and trustworthy protagonists. I needed to get deeper into the heads of my characters. In both the Interprime and the Off-Court series, the police officers were pretty ordinary people you as a reader could identify with. And the idea was to see how these pretty ordinary people reacted to extreme situations. The world around them could turn into hell and mayhem. But in this world of hell and mayhem, there were people to trust, really trustworthy police officers. I took a step to the side and threw away most of my usual suspects, most of what I had known and learned as an author. From the beginning, I just needed something completely new and fresh. I wasn't consciously trying to be unpolitical. The politics and social reality wasn't what I was looking for. For quite some time, I thought that I was finally writing some pure entertainment. Nothing. Instead of thick books with multiple and complex themes in a web-like plot. Books that took weeks to read. I was now writing a super tight book, perfectly designed for one intense, sleepless night of reading, and then it was going to be over. But working on what was to become watching you, I soon realized that I basically just shifted the perspective. Where I earlier had these trustworthy police officers in a weird way, at least trust these cops. I turned to a much more insecure narrative perspective with two very different cops. Some very normal. And you never really know who they are, what their goals are, what really make them tick. And I realized that the kind of slightly paranoid feeling that permeates this book is no less critical than what I did before. It's just the political state of today's world seen from inside our heads. This new feeling that you really can't trust anyone anymore. This general paranoid feeling of the first Birmingham booming. Book turned, however, out to be perfect for spy stories. So behind the psychological density of watching you lurked a much bigger web of deception and betrayal that continues in books 2 and 3, turning them into more political, more European books. So it's a trilogy that combines psychological thriller, crime fiction, spy novel, and maybe even a bit of horror. And now I have just finished the fourth book in the trilogy, which probably indicates how much I enjoy writing this kind of prose. In my mind, there are a few really obvious shifts going on in crime fiction today. One is the movement towards escape from the evil world, pure entertainment, selling as many books as possible. Another one is domestic noir, and in a way, my trilogy of Peregrine Boom is at the outskirts of this tendency. The general public perception in Europe has changed. Crime has, or at least so it seems, come closer to home. There is no really safe space anymore. Even the people closer to you could become something from. Could be something completely different than they have always seen. And what violence could be just around the corner. But crime fiction also remains a measurement of something good. It measures the distance to evil. Yes, it has come significantly closer in the last years. But as long as we have crime fiction, evil is at a distance. The distance is necessary to enjoy and get sucked into a good crime story. as long as we keep reading crime fiction, even in studies. Nobody reads crime fiction in Aleppo. Crime fiction has merged with other genres, so the best ones are getting more and more interesting. And I do believe the genre remains a vital part of modernity, and therefore a vital part of Europe. We need the thrill, we need the mystery, we need the horror, the chaos. But we also need the rational solution, how rationality slowly and by hard work defeats irrationality, so that at the end some clarity will shine through. Somehow we seem to need to dive deep into the abyss to learn to appreciate the light. The crime fiction writer that today aspires to find a voice for Europe through crime fiction has to work pretty hard to get to that light. But, on the other hand, it is the promise of crime fiction that there is, after all, a light at the end of the tunnel. Thank you.